Jesse Chapman. Come on down. Jesse's going to read the scripture for us. Hey, Jesse, what grade are you in?
Sixth
grade. And now the family that you come from, are you like an only child?
No.
Oh, so you have just a few brothers and sisters. How many do you have?
Seven.
Wow, that's a lot. And I'm grateful that you're here, and I'm grateful that you're going to read the scripture. Why don't you come up here so that everybody can see you and listen to you? And why don't you stand for the reading of God's Word this morning as Jesse reads it for us?
I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an image in the form of anything in the heaven above, on the earth beneath, or on the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the sin of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of your Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless for who misuses his name. Remember the seventh day by keeping it holy. 6 days and you will labor and do all your work. On the seventh day is the Sabbath to your Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor your foreigner residing in your homes. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. Let me rest on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that they may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet against your neighbor's house. You shall not covet against your neighbor's wife, or his male or female servant, or his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor.
People of God, this is the Word of God. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you for your Word impressed it upon our hearts. Thank you that Jesse comes from a family where they're impressing it on his heart, and that he can look to his mom and dad and his grandparents and see that faith going from generation to generation. And Lord, one day, Jesse's going to be a dad, and he's going to be doing it for his kids as well. We want to do what you've asked us to do. So thank you for reminding us of that in the scriptures this morning. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Join everyone to like. Thank you, folks. You may be seated. We're in a series here called the Big Ten. And the Big Ten is about the Ten Commandments. And we gave an introduction to that last week, of why we're studying this over these next few weeks. And we're studying it because we believe that God has given us a better way to live. And the same thing that he did back at Mount Sinai, way back in Exodus 20, that those commandments, they were once again reinforced by Jesus and through the New Testament. And we're still called to live this way today. We said last week, God didn't give these commandments because he was somehow having a bad day and wanted to make life difficult for his people. He gave us these very commandments because he chose a better pathway for us, a pathway that would be filled with fullness and blessing. Remember, the mission statement of the evil one, the devil, is to lie and to steal and to destroy. And Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and that you would have it to the full. Now look at our world today. So what we see in our world today is we see a country that was actually founded upon so many of these principles that we see in the Ten Commandments. I mean, actually, when you go to some of our civic structures in Washington, D.C., you'll you actually see the Ten Commandments etched in stone. Have we been a perfect nation? I think the emphatic answer to that is no. Have any of you been perfect people? I think the emphatic answer to that is no. But nonetheless, when we have and seek to follow what God has said in Scripture, we can experience that fullness. And now we don't have to look very far on the news to see that there's a lot of lying, and that there's a lot of stealing, and that there's a lot of destruction going on. And do I need to repeat where that comes from? So here, as Christians in 2020, God is once again reminding us, you want life to the full? Then do what I ask, because I love you. I'm zealous for you, and I'm zealous for you. So last week we began with commandment number one, no other gods before me. And today we move into commandment number two, of which is about making graven images. And even as we begin this morning, I thought about this. When we talk about, you know, perhaps making little gods, and what do people think of when they think about graven images? They will immediately think, well, I've got this commandment down. This is not me. I've got this one covered. There's others that I might have some issues with, but graven images, that's not an issue for me. I mean, really, we don't have anything like little Buddhas in our homes or things like that, right? You can see those out there in homes or businesses. Nope, not us. No graven images. Matter of fact, Pastor Bob, as far as I'm concerned, you can skip this one and go right on to number three. Well, let's just wait on that. You know, if we did pause and ask the question, if we were to make a graven image of God, what would that look like? If we were going to try with some human hands to do that, what would that look like? It would be like a history scholar trying to summarize the history of the world in one sentence. It would be like trying to play Beethoven's Fifth Symphony with a referee's whistle. It would be like making Mount Rushmore out of a granule of sand. In other words, it can't be done. It can't be done because of the greatness of our God. So when we make any sort of image, we tend to worship that. And that's what God had in mind. And when we worship those, we're worshiping literally shadows, not the one true God. It's interesting to note that God was giving these commandments up on top of Mount Sinai. Remember, on the cover of your bulletin, that's a picture of Mount Sinai. The mountains aren't so huge in Israel, but there was Moses up on top of this mountain, and God is speaking to him. What's going on below? Well, the people are literally creating a golden calf, something that looks like a big bull, because they wanted something that would represent God and be strong, and thus that big bull, strong and mighty. Was God offended by this? Most definitely, to the point that Moses had to beg God not to destroy them. So let's look at the commandment. Let's pull it apart a little bit, because I think it's important. Because there was a lot that Jesse read in there with this commandment specifically. So there's the rule, there's the reason, and there's the warning, and there's the promise that all comes within a couple of sentences. So what was the rule? Laid out like this. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. There's the rule. Don't make any idols or images. Don't make things that could be objects of worship. So what could that be today? Well, there's a variety of things. You know, one of the things that we as Christians, as Protestant Christians, we often have crosses. We have crosses on our stage. We have crosses sometimes in our church in different places. People people even wear crosses around their neck. And then there are others that have crucifixes. And crucifix, the difference between a crucifix and a cross is Christ is on the cross. Of course, we're not to worship that cross. That cross is a representation of the salvation that we have through Jesus Christ. Notice that Christ is not on the cross. Praise the Lord, because he did die, and he did go into a tomb, and he did raise from the dead 3 days later. So we don't worship that cross, and certainly we shouldn't worship Christ or bow down to Christ on a crucifix. And there are people who do that. But now, how about something in this room? Now, I'm going to say some things that at face value might seem a little bit ridiculous, but be careful. Sometimes people worship pews. Sometimes people worship a communion table or where it's located. Sometimes people worship stained glass. Sometimes people worship a hymn book or a certain instrument that might be in and around the stage. And so that might shake us a little bit, because you say, well, Pastor Bob, I got to be the first to admit, I like my pew, but I don't worship it. Are you sure? Are you sure? I'm pretty sure if the pews disappeared this week, there would be civil war at First Reformed Church. And you didn't just laugh because you all got a funny answer. See, what happens is we begin to elevate things to places where they shouldn't go. Now, I don't want to give you the message at all that God doesn't appreciate beauty. I believe that God is the author of beauty, and that God has put into the hearts and into the hands of people to create beautiful things. And this is a beautiful church. And I love even hearing the stories of it, of the stories of its architecture and what went into this and what went into the building of this. And I do appreciate so much the stained glass windows, this beautiful sculpture behind me, the stained glass behind me. All of these things are beautiful. Praise the Lord for them. But they have to be kept in their proper place. Otherwise, we can get out of whack when it comes to worship. What do we just say? I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. Jesus doesn't need a pew. Jesus doesn't need stained glass. Jesus doesn't care if the communion table is here or there or not even here at all, because it's all about Jesus. And so the commandment is very clear. I mean, do you see the detail? It says nothing in the heavens above or that in the earth beneath or in the waters that cover the earth. I don't want anything that would get in the way of you worshiping me. That's what God says. So that's the rule. Well, what's the reason? Well, look at the next phrase. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. So last week when we talked about jealousy, we talked about how jealousy is a synonym for zealous. We said over and over that God says to you, I love you. I love you. I'm jealous for you. And I'm zealous for you. The Lord pursues us. He goes after us. He wants us. He wants to show his affection to us. He calls us, be faithful. Be faithful to me. I am the only God. He can't help but be jealous for us, since his love for us is so great. And jealousy is God's love protecting itself. And of course, the Lord desires love in return. He doesn't want anything to get in the way of this love for us. And we talked even about a marriage that's there. We see in the Old Testament that many theologians say happened right there at Mount Sinai. And a marriage, is any wife crazy when she says, husband, I want you only to love me, no other women? Of course not. That's what you'd expect a wife or a husband to say to each other. And so God says that to us. There's the reason. What about the warning? The warning that comes to this. Says this, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate them. You know, this is a tough thing for people to understand at times, that at face value it seems quite threatening. And I want you to know that this is not a reference to some sort of a generational curse. This does not mean that a righteous child, is somehow going to be cursed because of their unrighteous parent. However, if a child now begins to repeat the same sins of their father and or mother, then that will go down another generation and another generation and another generation until one of those children says, enough, it's going to stop with me. And so we need to be careful. When we put youth sports before the things of God, our kids can pay for that in the next generation when they do the same thing. Dad, when you want to make football on Sunday or sleeping in more important than the things of God, be careful, because our kids can pay for that when they do it in the next generation. Parents, when you don't pray with your kids and teach them the Bible and impress the words of Scripture on them, they can pay for that in the next generations when they don't do it either. So there are consequences, parents, for our actions that are contrary to what God would have us do. And there are consequences for those things that we neglect that God says that we should do. And I'm asking you lovingly, as your pastor, please be careful. Because there can be a price to pay. Not seeking to be legalistic, to say, be careful. There's a promise here, and I want you to see the lavishness of the promise. But showing faithful love for 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commands. Did you see that? 1,000 generations. Well, the generation is 20 years. What's 1,000 generations? Like 20,000 years, right? Okay? So what the Lord is saying, hey, when you're faithful to me, when you do those things I've asked you to do, when you choose the more excellent way, what you are going to see is lavish blessings that are going to continue to come forth. The Lord wants to bless us, but we must be obedient. So there we have a little bit of unpacking this commandment. Here's something else I want you to remember this morning. Why is this commandment so important for us today in 2020? These are just some handles for you to get a hold of. Well, first of all, God is invisible. God is free. We are not to seek to contain him. So that which is invisible, don't make visible. No one has seen God. I mean, there's beautiful pictures. I believe it's Exodus chapter 33 where Moses wants to experience the glory of God. And that's where God hid him in the cleft of the rock and he passed by because he said, Moses, you can't handle me coming straight on. Okay? So no one sees God. His glory is magnificent. And so, don't make that which is invisible visible. And then, God is so big, why would we try to contain him? Sometimes we say things like this, and I don't want to get all out of sorts of this, but we say that this is God's house. We say that it's God's house as if God lives here. Well, this is as much God's house as your house should be when you go home, or your condo, or your apartment, or whatever. But God is not contained in this house. In other words, when you're on the parking lot, it's not as though God wasn't there, but he is here. And some would even say, well, this is God's sanctuary, so that when we're in the lobby, he's not there, but he's in here. Don't use language that contains God. Because our God is so much bigger than that. Don't contain him. And it's really rather simple when it comes to even creation. What does the psalmist say? The heavens declare the glory of God. What's the psalm? Let's just stop here for a moment. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world's It's a beautiful song that most of us know, and here's the deal. We don't worship the creation. What do we just sing so boldly? How great thou art. The heavens declare the glory of God. And then we also, the reason this commandment is so important is God is jealous. I need to keep reminding you of that. No image could possibly capture his glory. You know, in the ancient world, the people that were out there, all around God's people, they divinized all sorts of things. So they looked at the sun, they called it a god. They looked at the moon, they called it a god. They looked at the stars, they called it a god. All these gods everywhere. And so they were polytheistic. They had many gods. Well, God says to his people, one of the most important things that he demands of them, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Is one God. One God. You're not going to do that. Why? Because God created all those things. Don't make little gods out of them. His people were called to be different. And folks, we need to be very careful now because, see, in the world that we live in today, why would somebody refer to the Creator as that there's a Creator of all this beauty that we have out there? People will say things like Mother Nature. Mother Nature's been bad to us by not giving us rain. Or Mother Nature's getting angry because we haven't signed a climate control, some accord, whatever, out there. It's crazy. The same people who want to push out God out of everything will claim that Mother Nature is upset. That's a violation of this commandment. Be careful. Christianity is word-centered. It's word-centered. Let me give you a hint as to what the word is. This is the word. It's word-centered. We have the Bible. We should never apologize for being word-centered. We should never apologize like, oh man, other religions have all these artifacts and different things that they get to see, and all we've got is the Bible. No, we're the best off. We're the best off because God has revealed himself in the Scriptures. As a matter of fact, in our Theology for Regular People class the other night, we were talking about the Bible. And we said, this is God's special revelation to his people. It's incredibly special how this Bible came to be. How it's the authoritative, inspired, inerrant word of God. God breathed. Useful for all sorts of things. And the Bible declares all those things. And so, when you go to Europe, and if you've been there, and you've been in churches that were there before the Reformation, and in some of these big churches, there's all sorts of things that people will bow to when they walk in, and they'll have different rituals because they're meaningful things to them and that they need them in their worship. To the points that you go into some cathedrals. I remember going into the Dom Cathedral in Cologne, West Germany, and they literally have the bones of old popes in these boxes that you can see. Please, I beg of you, First Church, bury my bones. Don't put them in the lobby. Because these popes look very hungry. And they're seen as some sort of sacred things. Well, that's absolutely not biblical in any way. And then when the Reformation happened, they were building these Reformation cathedrals back in the 1600s. When you walk into these churches still to this day, there's nothing there in terms of images of any sort. But what they'll have is what they'll call a tester. In the middle of the church, they'll have this pulpit that will be over the people because what they realize is this. The only thing important to give to the people when they come to church is the Word of God. And that's where we're still at today. It's so very important. Listen to Deuteronomy 4:12. Then the Lord spoke to you from the fire. You kept hearing the sound of the words, but didn't see a form. There was only a voice. The Lord his people, speaking to his people from a fire. They weren't allowed to see God, but they heard his words. And then there's Romans 10:17 that says this, so faith comes from what is heard, and what is heard comes through the message about Christ. There's a great deal of emphasis in the scriptures on the sound of words, the sound of words. I've sat with many people who are sick, some people who are dying, that it's a great comfort to them in those moments that if I would just read the scriptures to them. And I'm always amazed at how much the scriptures will mean to people and how, through the power of the Holy Spirit, they will comfort and they will bless to read the very words of God to people. Another reason that the commandment is so important for today is this. God has made a way to himself through Jesus. God has always provided a way to himself, Old Testament and New Testament. And we see this be transformed all the way to Jesus. Think about it, the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, the first thing that God put together here was the tabernacle, this kind of portable church that went with God's people as they were traveling into the promised land. And then within, inside of this tabernacle, which was all laid out, beautiful floor plan that God had designed, there was the Holy of Holies, the Holy of Holies, there was the Ark of the Covenant. And that's where God was dwelling. And this is a very important place. So the Levites, the priests of that time, they were overseeing this. They were making sure that everything was done according to God's will. And of course, only one priest went in one time a year. This is how holy this place was. There was a lot of silence in that area because of the Ark of the Covenant. And then we know as time went on, the Ark of the Covenant was stolen one time by the Philistines, God's enemies. And we know that when the Ark of the Covenant got stolen by God's enemies, the Ark of the Covenant was nothing but trouble for those people. They thought that they would somehow get the power of God. They didn't get the power of God. They got the terror of God put into them. Well, then when the Ark of the Covenant came back, maybe you remember this story, but David, that great psalmist, and as the Ark of the Covenant came back, what did he do? He danced. And now there were times of silence before that around the Ark of the Covenant. Now there's dancing, now there's singing, now there's praising to our great God. And then a little bit later, David's son, Solomon, built the temple. And so this is put permanently in the temple. And so rather than being a moving church, it was right there in the Holy of Holies. And then what we see happening is prayer is so much more a part of the worship of God. So you have silence, you have praise and dancing, you have prayer. And then there came a time as the story unfolds where God's people were unfaithful. God's people were not following what we're talking about here today. To the extent that God said, you're going to be destroyed. And so we read in the book of Ezekiel chapter 10 where God's glory left. It left. It left the temple. And then, of course, everything was destroyed. Everything was destroyed. And the people entered into this time period. Well, where is God? Well, God was still there. He was not in the temple the way he was before. But then what was happening is through the prophets, we had to lean into the fact that there would be a Messiah coming one day. And then that Messiah did come. But he did not recognize him. But the Messiah came. Jesus was his name. And Jesus came. And now Jesus, we pray to the Lord in the name of Jesus. We do things in the name of Jesus. We don't need images of any sort because we have Jesus. And that's so vitally important for us. We're called in the scriptures to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. Jesus is the fulfillment of this commandment. And then when I think about why this commandment is so important, why do we need images? When in fact, right in the book of Genesis, it says that all of us are image bearers. You've certainly heard of that. We're all image bearers of God. So as image bearers of God, everybody on the planet is an image bearer of God. And then what God tells the Christians as image bearers of Him, you be my witnesses to those who don't know that yet. Because there's a lot of image bearers, even in a place like Pella or in this region, that don't know that they're image bearers of the one true God. So we're sent out in what's called the Great Commission to be Christ's witnesses, to let people know the gospel message. That's what we're called to do. And so now, in just the final moment here, how do I keep this commandment today? How do I keep this? Well, the first thing is, and I've already said this a couple of times, be on guard. The first commandment, no other gods before me, what did it say? It says, don't have any gods before me. The second commandment says, don't make any gods. Have and make. This is real. Be on guard. Watch out. I've been in a variety of churches in my ministry years, and I've watched people idolize things that still kind of make my head shake. I've had people say to me, if there's not wine in that communion cup, I don't know that communion is real. Really?
Really?
I had one man, we did this in a church where we had a really big communion table for a really small stage, so our worship team said, can we get a smaller communion for the stage? And we put a smaller communion table, had a person come into me and says, you've fully taken away the meaning of communion. I don't think I could take it if I had a little table there. I just sat stunned to think that a piece of wood would come in the way of him worshiping the Lord. It's very real. And so we have to watch out for this and be on guard. Don't let anything in here become a graven image for you. And then, what do you want when it comes to worship? We need to ask ourselves, what does the Bible say? If the Bible doesn't call for it, we don't need it. No, we've added things in here, okay? We've added things. There's no place in the scripture that says put stained glass in the church. But we've added that. It's beautiful. These stained glass windows, if you haven't noticed yet, they tell the story from Genesis all the way up to the ascension of Jesus Christ here. You say, well, that's fascinating. I'm not listening to you anymore. I'm just sitting in a different stained glass window every week. It's fascinating. I love it. Don't idolize it. Don't make it too important. So, I think of things like lights. One of the things that executive team went into the building, so we're looking at new lights because these lights are old, they're worn out, we can't replace their parts, and we need to buy lights here in the next couple of years. They're expensive. But I think they're lights. They help us to read. You know, there are churches that spend hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars on strobe lights and colored lights and flickering lights and smoke machines on their stage. And what they say is, people have come to expect this in church. They need it to be a stimulating environment. That's why we spend all this money. And I think, really, we have to be careful. We have to be careful with what we're going to do with the money that God has given to us to be good stewards of. Some people have said this. I'm sure nobody in here, I've already referred to this once, I'm not trying to beat a dead horse. Some people say, you know, unless I sit in a pew, I just don't feel like I'm at church. And if you're one of those people, here's my challenge to you. I beg of you to sit in a chair because your heart and your rear end are in the wrong places. Really, really. Please, church, be careful with this. And we're called to look to Jesus. He is the fulfillment of the second commandment. Look what it says in John 1:14. The Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. We observed His glory, the glory as the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is it. God gave us all we needed in Jesus, the author, the perfecter of our faith. God gave us everything we needed. Just look to Jesus. Jesus is all we need. And as Jesus is introduced to people in third world nations and the gospel is spreading literally all over the world, they don't have buildings. They don't oftentimes even have a complete Bible for each of them. But they keep saying, all we need is Christ. All we need is Christ. And we've got Christ. So I love this building that we get to gather in. It's beautiful. God has blessed us. But if we didn't have this, if we just met in a gym somewhere, we'd still have Jesus. And Jesus is all we need. Let's stand for closing prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for the story that goes all the way from Exodus throughout the scriptures of you revealing yourself to us on your agenda. And you wanted the best for your people. See, you didn't want us to have a bunch of gods. You wanted our affections all directed to you and to you alone. And so, Lord, for any rivals that are out there, even rivals that might be in this very room, Lord, we pray that they might be put down and that all of our focus would be upon you and you alone. And thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus, who did pitch his tent amongst us. Jesus, who is grace and truth perfected. We're so grateful that you have given us so much in Jesus to follow. And may that be our only desire. So for anyone here, Lord, who doesn't know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior, Lord, that perhaps right now would be that time. Because as we admit our sins and confess those sins and repent of those sins, we know that you're going to forgive those. And when we believe that you are our Savior and Lord and commit to following you all the days of our life, that's what it means to be a Christ follower. And may there be those that make decision today to forsake all else, all other gods, and say Jesus is the one and only. Oh God, have your way with us, for it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.